Okay, so this video is all about website design and 5 hints, 5 hacks, 5 tips to make your website look like it was designed by a professional, even if you really don't have any design skills at all. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. And my first tip, hint number one, is to create a color palette. And if you're like me, colors might not exactly be your thing. I mean, if somebody were to tell me to come up with a color combination, I'd probably come up with something like, I don't know, black and gray and maybe a little bit of white. Really not good with colors. But if you want to make your website look great, using a great color combination can be a great way to do that. So how do you come up with a great color combination even if you're not good with colors? Well, one thing that I've found that's extremely helpful for this is a tool called Palettons. Let's go ahead and check it out. Okay, so this here is the Palettons tool. It's a really simple and easy to use tool. Basically, all you do is you pick a base color. So right now we've got this base red color here, and then you can just choose from either this sort of adjacent colors color scheme, and you can see the color scheme right here on the right. We've got this triad color scheme, so it's pulling colors from different sides of the color wheel, and then this tetrad, where it's pulling colors from sort of across the color wheel here. And then if you want to make additional adjustments here, you can adjust the distance that it's pulling it from. So it's a great way of quickly making a great looking color palette. And then what I like to do is I just like to click on this tables and export button here, and then click on as HTML. And then I just print this page, or actually I just save this page as a PDF, and I save it into a folder that I can use to reference whenever I need colors for my website. Okay, and then if you don't know what the color of something is, but say you've got a logo already and you want to use the color that's in that logo as the starting point for a color palette, it's really easy to do if you're on a Mac. Let me show you how to do that. Okay, so if you're on a Mac, just go up here to the search and then just type in digital color meter, and that's going to pop up right there. And then under the settings for this, we want to make sure our colors are displayed as hexadecimal. So we're just going to click on view and then display values, and then make sure hexadecimal is checked. I've already checked it on here, but by default it's set to decimal, so it's set to hexadecimal. Okay, and then we can use it to find the color of just about anything. So let's just pull up the digital color meter, hover over what you want to find the color of, and then you can see right over here that we've got the hexadecimal color, which is the colors that we're going to use on our website. So it's E09900 is what it is for this example. And then you can just take that and you can just type it into the Palettons color palette here. And there we go. Now we can just select which color palette we think looks the best based on that. And you're off and running. Okay, hint number two is use great looking images. Now this can be challenging. I mean, for me, I like taking pictures. I really enjoy photography. If you don't enjoy photography, or if you're not so good at taking pictures, how do you get great pictures for your website? Well, there's two ways of doing it. One way of doing it is to hire a photographer. If you can afford it, having custom images for your website is a great way to make your website stand out and also have the images be extremely relevant to you and your business. Now, what if you don't have any money to hire a photographer and you still want to use, and you should use, great looking images on your website? What should you do? Well, there's some great resources where you can find either paid stock images like iStock Photo or Shutterstock, and then there's also some free resources that you can use like Unsplash and Pixabay Photos. And actually, I've shared some of the photos that I've taken on Unsplash so that anybody can use, and it's a great resource for designers and anyone who needs to use great looking images. Now, be sure you check out what the rules are when you're using these images. For example, some images of people that have recognizable faces where you can recognize the face of the person may have some restrictions on them. And then even inside the images, there may be some restrictions. So for example, if it has an image of a Coca-Cola logo, or if it has an image of an iPhone or a Mac or some other recognizable piece of design, you may need to get additional rights for that. So you just want to look into that and see what the rules are for that. You definitely want to use great looking images. So Unsplash, Pixabay, iStock Photo, and Shutterstock are some great resources for that. Okay, now hint number three is one that actually I struggle with all the time. It's not that I forget, it's just, I don't know, sometimes it seems really hard to implement this hint, and that is space. Just adding a little bit of extra space around all of the elements that you put on your website. This goes especially for text, so you want to have space around your headings, space around the body of your text. And one of the new trends in website design, and I think it's actually a really good one, is when you're making a point in text, so if you're, you know, writing something, is to make your paragraphs really short. I mean, your paragraph or the spacing between lines might actually just be one line, and then you're going to have spaces between those. And what that allows your viewers to do when they're looking down your website website is quickly scan for the information that they're looking for. So adding extra space around all of the elements in your website, not only the text, but the images and the graphics, to allow your users to sort of see what they are, scan them, and have that space around them to draw their eye to it. It's a really good technique, and it's one that I struggle with, but it's something that everyone should try to implement on their website and their website design. Okay, and then hint number four is, it's about being decisive. And for me, that means getting rid of using sliders. And I'll link down to some articles down below that talk about why you shouldn't use sliders, why they're bad for SEO, and why they don't actually drive more interaction on your website. But when you just think about it, I feel that whenever I've wanted in the past to use a slider, the reason why I wanted to is I just couldn't decide what the most important thing to put at the top of my website. So I decided I'll just put a bunch of different things, and I'll just put a slider and, you know, let people decide for themselves what the most important thing is. The problem with that is that people don't sit around and wait for your slider to cycle through. What they do is they're proactive. You're on an interactive website, so they just start scanning down your page and looking for what it is that they're looking for. Now, what I recommend doing is putting the most important thing you have at the top of your website, and then the subsequent things that you think are less important, you can even make them look basically like slides, and put those down as the next thing. So let your viewers scan down the page to see what they want. Now, one problem you might have is that you just don't know what the most important thing is, what the thing is that you should put at the top of your website, because you're not sure what's the most important thing for your audience. The best thing to do is to test. And if you're using a theme like the Divi theme, which is one of the themes that I recommend using, they have a function for A/B split testing right inside the theme. And this allows you to test, well, just about anything, but specifically you can test the header section and see which variation of the header section performs the best for your audience. So you come up with a couple of different variations, and then you set a target, maybe lower down on the page, maybe it's having them scroll all the way down to the page, maybe it's having them click on a button, whatever the target is, whatever the action that you're trying to get them to do, you figure out which of your test subjects got them to take that interaction the best, and that's probably one of the best ways of finding out what should be at the top of your website. Hint number five is to remember your mobile viewers. And when you're building your websites, you're doing it on a desktop computer. So it's really easy to forget that people might be viewing your websites on tablets and on mobile devices. And Google has made it abundantly clear that people use mobile devices a lot for viewing websites. So you want to make sure that your website looks great on mobile. And so what that means is taking just a little bit of extra time and tweaking your designs so that you're sure that they look good on any kind of device, any size screen that your viewers might be coming to. A lot of the great WordPress page builder themes out there, like the Divi theme, Beaver Builder, and Elementor, all allow you to tweak your designs specifically for mobile devices. So it's something you want to do. Just take a little bit of extra time after you've designed your pages, making sure everything looks good on mobile devices, phones, and tablets. And then one last tip, one bonus tip here, is font combinations. And I think it's something just good to decide right when you start creating your website is font combinations. A lot of the themes out there, particularly the Divi theme, and most themes out there will allow you to decide what you want your default fonts to be. And so deciding that ahead of time can be a great way of distinguishing your website from other websites and giving it a good characteristic look. And I'll link down below to some resources for some font combinations that you might want to use on your website. So if you're brand new to making websites and you're not sure where to start, check out my little free mini course on YouTube and on my website, where I'll guide you through step by step exactly the steps that you need to take to build a WordPress website. And if you're already following along with that tutorial series, the next tutorial is how to install a WordPress theme. We're going to be looking at how to install the Divi theme. And then after that, we're going to learn how to build web pages. So go ahead and click on whichever video you want to watch next.